Roberta, played by Lil Son Jackson, chosen by Eric Clapton, and in fact Eric's covered one of his songs on his mother's new record. And you said that was one of the first records you ever had. Where, when you say first record, is that an actual record? Where did you get your first record?
I used to browse, there were only a couple of shops in London that you could get stuff like that from. One was Dobell's on Charing Cross Road, and the other one was HMV on Oxford Street, and they had really deep, extensive jazz and blues libraries, you know. And
what sort of age were you when you were
trying to... I suppose 16, you know. So 15, 16, something like that.
And what had made you want to go and look into a blues?
I'd heard, I heard some of the more popular contemporary artists of the time, like Bo Diddley and Chuck Berry, on the radio, and whatever it was that compelled me to research where they came from took me to these shops. And I can't remember who recommended I go there. I just seemed to have, someone must have done. I can't remember who it was. It seemed to me that it was like peeling an onion, you know, after listening to Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley, then I heard Muddy Waters, who was the next layer down. Then after that, it was just a question of going back. And as I went, you know, I was listening to parallel music too, so New Orleans jazz that went back to Jelly Roll Morton, to King Oliver and Louis Armstrong and Hot Five, at the same time as I was discovering Robert Johnson and Son House and Charlie Patton and those people.
Were your friends and contemporaries who were also 15, 16, were they listening to that sort of music, or were they listening to the pop radio or whatever?
I had found a couple of guys at school that were into the blues and country blues too. I think the country blues thing was quite obscure and not very interesting to most people. It was very interesting to a couple of people, and there were some very famous guys around there, like Neil Slade and, you know, Mike Leadbitter, who they were kind of started Blues Unlimited, the magazine, and Paul Oliver. Obviously, these became the experts, and they knew it. But on the whole, I think people that like that kind of music were thin on the ground.
Mm. Now, that we'll talk more about that maybe in a moment, and you getting into that sort of music, which then, of course, interestingly, which I'd like to go into as well later, is you then kind of reintroduced in lots of ways, or you were certainly one of the main people reintroducing that music back to the country that it had come from. Later on, but let's play something else from your record, and there's some really beautiful covers on here, and here is, I think we should just play it, here's When Somebody Thinks You're Wonderful.
When somebody thinks you're wonderful, what a difference in your day. Seems as though your troubles disappear like a feather in your way. When somebody thinks you're wonderful, tells you with a smile so sweet, what a little stones you step upon, set the metal neath your feet. When somebody thinks you're wonderful,
Yeah, it certainly puts me in a Christmassy frame of mind. When somebody thinks you're wonderful, when you did that, where did you record that? How did that get recorded?
I'd just come out of the hospital. This was at the end of 2009 when I had a gallstone, and it was trying to move out of my gallbladder, and I went into hospital to have the gallbladder taken out.
Very painful.
Very nasty. Very nasty. And they put me on morphine, and when I was coming out of the morphine, trying to come off the morphine as quick as I could, because don't like that stuff much, and I got very low, and these songs came into my head from my youth, because I heard these songs when I was a kid, being my mum and my uncle used to listen to Fats Waller a lot, and they kind of they buoyed me up, and at the same time Doyle Bramhall was going and Justin Stanley were going down to New Orleans to put some horns on one of the tracks.
Who were producing the record.
Producing the record. And I said, while you're down there, see if you can manage to cut some tracks on these songs. I'd done this song, When Somebody Thinks You Want, and my very good friend, Milkman. And they got hold of Trombone Shorty and Alan Toussaint, and they went in, I think, with Alan's band and a combination of different musicians, and they cut these. And the funny thing was, though, that Alan said, we need to know what Eric's concept of this is, what his sort of feel will be. So I got my little iPhone, and I recorded me in my dressing gown at home playing on acoustic guitar, the way I heard it, And then I emailed it to them, and they then played it over the speakers and played along with it. And so when it came time for me later on to add my bit, to add the vocal and put the guitar, the slot was already there because there was a phantom space for me.
And you said it is the music of joy, isn't it? That sort of tragedy.
Well, it certainly lifted my spirits at that time. I was very, very low after that op. And it's something about music that just can transform your feelings.
Yes, I've seen that actually with people, anybody who's feeling a bit down or a bit ill as well. It's for those moments they're enjoying the music, they're liberated from whatever the difficulty is. Did you play with trad bands when you were young, when you were first playing?
I was a very very good friend of a trombone player called The Peddler in Kingston on Thames, and he had a band called the Canal Street Jazz Band, and from time to time I was allowed to play either guitar or six-string banjo. Not often, but it was... I grew up loving that music too, New Orleans jazz, not Dixieland. I think it was a big difference for me.
How would you describe the difference to the listeners?
Well, it was it's a racial thing almost. I always thought Dixieland was the watered down version of New Orleans jazz, really. It was the commercial. Dixieland was the acceptable face of New Orleans jazz, if you know what I mean.
And the next thing you've chosen, that was a Fats Waller song. Is a Fats Waller song. Tell us about the one you've got, Blue Turning Gravy.
It's just a lovely, it's a lovely piece of music that really, I mean, I don't think, if you didn't, because it's not a vocal, it's not one of his sort of pop record things, that you would just enjoy it from a jazz point of view. It's a lovely composition, and it's really much more kind of make this sort of jazz mainstream than the normal thing he would do, sort of novelty songs and things. Thank you.